Alright, I think it's time for an update on the Taurus. Been working away for 2 weeks on this thing. Almost got it ready to go for its next run. This car will be running on August 25th. That is a Saturday at the Dark County Fair, Greenville, Ohio. I still have a little bit more sheet metal work to do on this corner until I'm happy. Because I really don't want that to cut into the tire if it does try to go down. As you saw with other videos, we pre-bent the backs up in the air pretty good. We got a slice in the frame. Hood will be going back on soon once I get the stuff under the hood fixed. I'm working on now. And if you saw my last video, you went on the trip with us to the junkyard, and I got new electric fans for this car. The electric fan that I had been using was that one right there. And I have another one right there on the wall. That's a good one. This one here is bad. It's knocked off of the motor, I believe, or the bearings locked up. It's junk. That one over there actually does work. That's off of a 90s Lincoln. One of our teammates' cars from a year or two ago. That still worked when we took it out, so we kept it. So I may use that on a full size sometime if I ever want to. I'll show you the problem we had with this kind of fan versus these new style of fans I picked up. This fan here, on the plus side, it is very slim, does not take up too much space in between the radiator and the engine. That's what you want. The less space taken up, the more room your car has to crush in before this fan gets broke. Now, if you want to see why it's broken, watch when I try to spin it. See how it doesn't keep spinning? It just keeps sticking every time I spin it. Now, something like these, they keep spinning on their own for a while. Again, that's how you can tell if these fans are still good. At least as far as the bearing goes and stuff like that. Now, the motor could be burnt up on either one of these new fans. I don't know. I will test them, and I'll show you guys how to test them here in a different video. Probably the next video I upload after this one. I'll be sure to show you. We're going to test this fan and that fan. But yeah, this fan, it's junk. And the reason it's junk, besides the reason that it's broken, if you look here, that motor actually pokes out a little bit wider than the actual shroud going around it. So if I were to take this fan and push it tight against the radiator, when this thing spins, this centerpiece is touching the radiator and spinning into it and cutting it open. So the only way to mount this thing is by flipping it around backwards and mounting it tight that way. Then having the airflow go through the radiator through this end of it, which is not how it was actually hooked up on the original Taurus I pulled it off of. By the way, this here is off of a 1996 and newer Taurus. I don't remember if it's the 2000s and newer, or if it was just the 96 to 98 style, or 99, something like that. Can't remember. If you guys want to go look at the video, go for it. I can't remember off the top of my head. But yeah, whenever you strap this thing down, this sucker's going to rub. Now, you're saying, okay, put this end of it up against the radiator. Well, the problem is, in order to strap this, I run my two straps, which I have right there. Those ratchet straps is what I use to hold this thing tight against the radiator. Well, when you loop those over this and down these sides, you have a strap that goes across here and a strap that goes across here, and you push that tight against your radiator. Well, when this thing spins, it would rub on them straps with the blades. So there's no winning with this style of electric fan. You would almost have to make an extra bracket to mount it to your radiator without the fan rubbing on something. It just sticks out too much. Now, the Taurus I took this off of had two of these on it. That's why I have another one over there. And those two were both actually attached to a metal bracket hooked to the car itself. If you've ever seen the newer Ford Taurus, I want to run one of them in a derby because I'm really curious on the front end on them. I do know they have a fiberglass cover over the core support, but there is metal under them. Well, where the radiator is, there's actually metal on this side of the radiator, covering most of the radiator. Then there's holes in that metal, and these bolt into those holes, And it only has a hole right there for the airflow. The rest of the radiator is enclosed. Looks like you can kind of make them things pretty solid up front. I'm sure I could find a way. So that's why I'm not using the other one of those fans right now, until I come up with a better way to mount them. One thing I did like about these, I will mention, compared to other electric fans, if you look, these fans have three different wires. The black is always your ground, and red is always the hot wire. If you notice, there's a gray one. I believe these fans had two different settings. They had a high and a low. So when you're just driving, these fans would operate at low speeds, just spinning around. And if the car was overheating or becoming really hot, the fan would kick in into high mode, and it would go really fast. When I tested these, hooked them to the battery, I hooked them to this red one, and these things spun real fast. So I believe I had them on the high mode versus the slow version. I took this and taped it aside. These other fans I picked up, they only have two wires. That one, and this new one here. So obviously, one's a positive and one's your ground. Depending how I mount these, depends which one I'll put positive and negative to. Because if I reverse the wires, and I put the positive to my ground, I put my ground to the positive, the fan will actually spin backwards. So depending which way you want the air to blow, and which side of the radiator you have it mounted on, that determines how you want to wire your electric fans. Now, I haven't decided which one of these I want to use on the Taurus yet. This one here is definitely a lot thinner. Very slim. And I do like that metal shield that's around it. Versus this one, which is pretty wide, only because of the motor. But it does have a very nice plastic bracket to mount to the radiator. I believe, though, if both of these work, I'm going to save this one, which is out of a Sunfire, a newer Sunfire, 2000s, I believe. I'm going to keep that for a different derby car. I'm going to use this one now because it's so small, and I kind of need the clearance on this car. As you can see, I have a new radiator put in here, the old one sitting outside. It's not strapped down, by the way, so it's kind of leaning towards the engine. It will actually be sucked up tight against the core support here. I just have my new foam padding I just put in, so it's pushing it away. That's why the hose is all bent here. Once I strap that tight, it'll open this hose back up, and that'll be nice and fine. I put padding on every radiator in every single corner, so when this core support bends, it won't snap the corners as easy on these plastic-sided radiators. They're very weak. They can bend in the middle pretty good, but the sides, no. I'll show you. For anybody that hasn't been following on my fan page, I did post pictures of the old radiator out of the Taurus, and, well, you can definitely tell where it broke at. If you look right here, you see this giant crack runs the whole length of that corner, from tip to tip. And I don't know if this thing just got so hot, because remember my electric fan broke in the first minute on this car. So this thing was running hot the whole derby. I don't know if the pressure cracked that and split it open because maybe that was the weakest point. Or if that top cap actually broke and got hit against something. I think that may have been the reason it broke. I think when my engine broke loose, it flopped and something caught this and it took this fill neck and it bent it that way. And it cracked this open when it bent that fill neck. And that's when the radiator probably blew and sprayed a bunch of water out. Which is when I had a head-on hit. If you watch my in-car camera, somebody hit me head-on. And that's when all the steam blew up. And I believe that's when this cracked open. Because other than that, this thing is just fine. All these fins, none of them are broken or damaged at all. You can see I did a patch job on this at one time. This actually used to be out of my driver. This radiator here, my 1989 Sable that I drive, which is that car right there. And that thing was leaking around the seal, so I just did a huge mess of pipe cement. There's some rubber cement, there's some window caulking, anything I could find that was against liquids, I just layered it, one on top of the other one, And that thing never leaked once I did that, just so you know. That is a good temporary fix if the seal's going out on these plastic-ended radiators, because they will do that after a while. So there's the update on electric fans. And one last update you guys will be happy to hear before I go. I have the shifter problem fixed, I hope, at least. When this engine broke, it took my shifter cable and it stretched it when the engine flopped over. And what it did is it ripped that outside coating off of my shifter cable, so the wire was exposed in the middle. When I shifted, I could pull on the shifter just fine, and it would shift it pulling. When I went to push the shifter, the cable would not push the lever. Instead, it popped out of that coating hole, and the wire would stick out. And it was only a one-way shifter, pretty much. Once you went into drive, you could not shift out of drive. I tried getting a cable for this car, just going and getting a cable for a Taurus. You'd think that'd be easy to find, but no. Since this is a 1990 Taurus, they actually do not make cables for the 86-295 Ford Taurus anymore. The only ones that exist are the ones you could find online, which aren't that common either. So, if I do get more Tauruses, which I probably will, I'm going to start saving them cables in case I ever need them. I'm going to start actually saving that off a lot of my cars, things I didn't think I would need. What I did instead was I bought a performance racing floor shifter. It's a cable powered floor shifter. It's got a 5-foot cable, I believe. And you can see, let me zoom in on it. Right there is the bracket on top of my transmission that shifts it. You see the welds right there. I welded that bracket on from the old one. And that rod right there is the new cable shifter hooked into place. It's pretty hard to see. But right there, that blue, that's the new cable shifter going down there and underneath the car. I still have to fasten it down under the car. I'm going to put holes through the floor and wire it up tight against the floor. It's running actually in the tranny, the tunnel that runs through the middle of the floor, that hump, that I have the cord up in there. So if I run something over, it should not catch on the cord. And I'll show you this shifter here. It's actually a pretty nice shifter. I'm happy with it. It's a B&M Unimatic cable shifter. I think it was like $140 on the internet. It's supposed to be for rear-wheel drive cars. I converted it and made it for a front-wheel drive. We're going to see if this works or not. It's the only option I had left to get this car fixed in time, so I'm running out of days to work on this. It is just bolted right there to the floor. And it has a park lockout feature, which is very nice for derby use. I just take it. Oh, by the way, the handle is turned sideways. It's supposed to be turned this way for normal. But I have my transmission lines right here, so I cannot have this turn the other way. It'll hit them. So I turned it like this, and I'm just going to actually grab the bar when I shift it for now. Whenever I build my next compact, I will put this shifter in right away and design the interior around the shifter. Since this is a last-minute add, I didn't have a chance. But yeah, in order to move it, grab it. And right there is all the way forward. Then grab this handle and shift back. You can hear it click into every gear. And that's all the way back. And then if you want to go into park, you push down on the shifter. And right there is park. And it will not come out of park unless you push down on the shifter and then click. So it's a good safety mechanism. I cannot accidentally put it into park in the derby. So right there should be reverse, then neutral, and drive. Well, this car has neutral, overdrive, then drive, and then one for low gear. So right there's back in reverse, and back in park right now. I gotta get used to it a little bit. I'll probably test drive the car to get used to using the shifter so I can shift quickly in the derby. And yeah, it just shifts down there. As far as I know, it seems to be shifting correctly because there's notches on the shifter and there's notches in your transmission, obviously. I think I have them adjusted so when I shift it one notch on there, it shifts it one notch on the transmission. I won't know for sure until I get this car running and drive it out for a test run, which won't be too much longer. The Thunderbird is in the shop now. I actually drove it back in here, pretty awesome. And I gotta pull my gas tank and my battery out of that Thunderbird and put it back here into the Taurus. I unfortunately only have one battery and one gas tank right now. With my upcoming purchase of a house, I've been very, very tight with my money, saving as much as I can. As soon as I get my own place, then I'll be buying a lot of Derby products. So you guys stay tuned for that. Just a lot of odd-end stuff I really need to make building these cars easier. So, there's a rather long update on what's happening with the Taurus, what's coming up next. Stay tuned, and I'll give you guys a hopefully a shorter video on testing out the new electric vans. We'll see if they're good.